This is a recital of a script of a film which can change the world, and you'd better listen to it. Mummy, Mummy, where's Daddy? He's in the pub with his friends getting drunk. It's Friday night. Now eat your supper. There's a good boy. Mummy, Mummy, why did Daddy go to the pub on Friday night and get drunk and come home and beat us up? I don't know, dear. Stop asking so many silly questions and eat your tea. It's past your bedtime. There's a good boy. Mummy, Mummy, when we went to school today, they told us that when people drink too much, it's because they want to forget about something they don't want to think about anymore. Is it because Daddy's a lumberjack and he has to cut down trees all day long? And Daddy loves the trees, doesn't he, Mummy? Yes, dear. He loves the trees. Now stop asking so many silly questions. Eat your supper. It's past your bedtime and he's going to be home soon. Mummy, Mummy, when we went to school today, they told us that when people drink too much, it's because they want to forget about something they don't want to think about anymore. Is it because Daddy's a lumberjack and he has to cut down trees all day? And Daddy loves the trees, doesn't he, Mummy? Yes, dear. He loves the trees. Now stop asking so many silly questions and eat your tea. It's past your bedtime and he's going to be home soon. Well, he eats his tea. He gets up to go to bed. On the way to bed, he says, Mummy, Mummy, when I grow up to be a lumberjack like Daddy, will I have to go down the pub and get drunk and come home and beat my wife and children up so I can forget how horrible it is to cut down trees all day long? No, dear, don't be silly. They've got nice things like Valium and Prozac these days. They've even got Ritalin for children. Now go to bed. Sweet dreams. Well, she's in the kitchen, cooking the tea for Daddy when he comes home, muttering under her breath, that bastard, if he comes, I'm drunk tonight, I'm leaving him, I've had enough, I'm lying to the children, it's driving me mad. Anyway, 5 minutes later, he comes in the door, he's got a black eye and he's hurt his leg. Don't expect any sympathy off me, you rotten bastard, to be down a fucking pub, getting drunk again. Look at the state of you. How dare you come home like this? I'm leaving you, I've had enough. She's off out the door. Well, he goes after her. He says, wait, 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 come back. I haven't been drinking, I haven't been fighting, and I haven't been down the pub. Smell my breath. She smells his breath, there's no alcohol. How do you get in such a state then? What's going on? Explain yourself, what's going on? Well, I went to work this morning, I couldn't stand it anymore. I'm cutting down trees all day, I love the trees. I'm coming home from work, the kids are telling me they hate me, I'm destroying the planet, they've got to live on for the rest of their lives. I've got to beat them, especially the boys, to make them into idiots like I am so they can get a job when they grow up. I went to the pub on Friday night, I got drunk, I come home, we had an argument, and I beat you and the children up, it's driving me bloody mad. So I went to work this morning, I told them to stuff a stupid job. You stupid man, she said. How do you think we're going to pay the mortgage and feed the children if you haven't got a job? Well, I've got another job. How did you get another job? I went to the job centre. Don't lie to me. You don't get a job in a job centre and one day it takes months and years. Now tell me the truth or you're never going to see me again. I'm telling you the truth, right? I never lied to you. Now just give me one chance. Okay, you've got one chance. Any lies or bullshit, you're never going to see me again. Well, I went to work this morning. I left the car behind. I decided I'm not going to damage the earth anymore. And I walked home and I thought I'd better try and get another job. So I went in the bike shed. I got the old bikes out. Do you remember on a honeymoon 15 years ago on the bikes? Been rusting away in there 15 years. Got rusty old wheels. Only one brake works. Anyway, I jumped on it. Went down the job centre. Probably wobbly down the road. Only one brake. Got the job centre about 9 o'clock in the morning. Took my ticket out of the machine. Sat down and waited. Waited. All day long. I finally got seen about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I went up to the guy behind the counter. He says, how can I help you? I said, I've been 15 years chopping down trees, destroying the planet which I live on, which my family live on, who I love and I'm trying to support, which my neighbour lives on. If I don't carry on doing it, I can't pay the mortgage. I'm coming home from work, my kids are saying they hate me, I'm destroying the planet. I've got to beat them to make idiots like me. The wife says, don't beat the kids. I went down to the pub Friday night, I got drunk, I come home and beat the wife up. I went to work this morning, I told them my stuff for a stupid job. Please, have you got an environment-friendly job for me? I'm awfully sorry, sir. We don't have environment-friendly jobs here. If you just sign a job seekers agreement, agreeing to take any work we offer you, we'll consider paying you some money. Listen, mate, I'm not signing a contract agreeing to damage the earth anymore. I told you, it's driving me fucking mad. I'm going to kill someone in a minute. Gets him on by the throat and starts taking him by the throat. I'm very sorry, sir. You're making yourself unavailable for work. Kindly leave the premises. We'll have to call the police. Well, I thought I'd better leave before I got arrested. On the way out, a little old lady came out from behind the counter. She said, young man, she said, you've got my deepest sympathy. I've been working here for 30 years. It's my last day today. I can finally speak my mind. I've seen people taken out of here on stretchers, in straitjackets, handcuffed, injected with Largacto on their neck and beaten for saying what you're saying. You've got my deepest sympathy. It so happens I've got a friend who's got a farm on the roof of a building over there. It's an organic farm and they've got cows on the roof and they're looking for a herdsman to stop the cows falling off the roof. I thought, perfect. I'm a lumberjack. I can go in the forest, I can cut down some trees, I can make a nice fence around the outside of the roof, I can replant the trees in the forest, it's an organic farm that'll keep my son happy, and with the offcuts of the wood, I can make myself a nice little bench and a shelter I can sit down and watch the cows all day. It's a perfect job, thank you very much. She said, young man, you're welcome, good luck with the job interview. So I left the job centre about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, about 4:30 in the afternoon by now, got back on the bike, on the way to job interview, washed the old wheels, wobbly wobbly down the road, only one break, going past the market. It's 4:30 in the afternoon. There's a load of bananas going to get thrown out on a banana stall. So I went up to the guy on the banana stall. He said, how can I help you? I said, I've been 15 years chopping down trees, destroying the planet, which I live on, which my family live on, who I love and I'm trying to support, which my neighbour lives on. If I don't, Karen, I can't pay the mortgage. I'm coming home from work. My kids are telling me they hate me. I'm destroying the planet. I've got to beat them to make idiots like me. The wife tells me don't beat the kids. I went down the pub. I got drunk on Friday night. I come home and beat the wife and children up. It's driving me bloody mad. I went to work this morning. I told them to stop a stupid job. I'm now away to a job interview on that farm over there, on that organic farm, on the roof of that building, stopping the cows falling off the roof. But even if I get the job, they're not going to pay me for 2 weeks. Is there any chance I can take some of those bananas so at least I've got something to put on the table for the wife and kids when I get home? Sure, mate. Take as many as you like. So I got two carrier bags, filled them up with bananas, put them in the handlebars of the bike, carried on down the road. Wobbly wobbly, rusty old wheels, only one brake. Going down the hill, going a bit fast, put the brake on. Brake cable snap, got no brakes. Faster and faster down the hill, ran a corner, fell off the bike. Ow, ow, ow! Well, the wife's looking at him. She doesn't know whether to laugh or cry or kick him in the balls. All right, you smart bastard. Where's all your bananas? I want to see your bananas. Get your bananas out now. Put your bananas on the table. Put your bananas where your mouth is. Well, I fell off the bike, didn't I? Bananas went all over the road. There was bananas all over the place. And guess what happened then? She says, don't give me guess what happened then. Well, another little old lady walking up the road with a shopping bag and a walking stick slips over and banana skin falls over and breaks her wrist. What am I going to do? Got a mobile phone, called ambulance. Ambulance came, took her away, and then the police came and they want to arrest me for riding my bike recklessly. I said, excuse me, officer. With due respect, I've been 15 years of my life chopping down trees, destroying the planet which I live on, which my family live on, who I love and I'm trying to support, and which my neighbour lives on. And if I don't carry on doing it, I can't pay the mortgage. I'm coming home from work, my kids are telling me they hate me destroying the planet, they've got to live on for the rest of their lives. I've got to beat them to make them idiots like me so they can get a job when they grow up. My wife says don't beat the kids. I went down to the pub on Friday night, I got drunk, I come home, we had a big argument, I beat my wife and children up. It's driving me bloody mad. I went to work this morning, I told them to stuff a stupid job. I'm now on my way to a job interview on that farm, on that organic farm up there, stopping the cows falling off the roof, so I can earn the money to buy new brakes for my bike without damaging the environment. Now, how can that be reckless? With due respect, officer. I'm awfully sorry, sir, but you must realise if you do something which is likely to injure your neighbour, and you do it knowingly, that is reckless and criminal. As a practical man, you say you're a lumberjack. You must have known your bicycle was in an unroadworthy condition. As a direct result of riding it in that condition, knowingly down the road, there's now a little old lady in hospital with a broken arm. I'm afraid, sir, I'm going to have to arrest you and take you down to the police station. Take me away. So I'm sat in the police cell, and I'm thinking about this offence of recklessness. To knowingly injure your neighbour is reckless and criminal. I've just been 15 years of my life chopping down trees, destroying the planet which I live on, which my family live on, who I love and I'm trying to support, and which my neighbour lives on. And if I don't carry on doing it, I can't pay the mortgage. So I called for the duty solicitor. About half an hour later, he came. He says, how can I help you?
When we went to school today, they told us...
What would happen if you had a legal contract forcing a person to commit a crime, to knowingly injure their neighbour? Oh, he says, that's very simple, sir. It's a void contract, sir. Unenforceable, sir. I mean, we can't have legal contracts forcing people to commit crime now, can we, sir? It'd be the end of the world as we know it, wouldn't it, sir? I said, oh, I said, that's very interesting. Thank you very much. That's very helpful. He said, well, had to be a service, sir. Walked out. So I'm sat in the police cell. And I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking, hold on a minute, I've just been down the job centre, right? They're trying to get me to sign a contract, agreeing to commit more of the same crime, the job seekers agreement, or they won't pay any money. So I called him back again, the duty solicitor. Another half an hour later, he came back again. He says, well, how can I help you this time, sir? I said, well, please could you tell me just another little thing? Please could you tell me what would happen if I was to sign a contract agreeing to commit a crime, to knowingly injure my neighbour? Oh, he says, you can get put in prison for that, sir. It's a criminal matter, sir. We can't have people going around signing contracts agreeing to commit crime now, can we, sir? It would be the end of the world as we know it, wouldn't it, sir? I said, I said, you're probably right. Thank you very much. That's very helpful. He said, well, glad to be of service, sir. Walked out again. I'm sat in the police cell, and I'm thinking away. I've been there a couple of hours by now. There's no pen and paper. The light's on, and there's nothing to read. You know, I'm thinking away, and I'm thinking to myself, hold on a minute, then. I've just been paying a third of my wages in tax to the government so they can make up all these laws so all this crime can happen, destroying the planet, and they're doing it knowingly, and I'm paying them to do it. No person's above the law in this country. The government is criminal and I'm paying them to commit crime. So I called him back again a third time. He says, well, what is it this time, sir? I said, well, one more thing to complete my defence. Please could you tell me what would happen if I was to pay someone to commit a crime, to knowingly injure their neighbour? Oh, he says, you can get put in prison for a long time, sir. That's 10 years in prison for that sort of thing, sir. We can't have people going around paying people to commit crime now, can we, sir? It'll be the end of the world as we know it, wouldn't it, sir? I said, thank you very much. That completes my defence. He said, well, good luck in court, sir. I walked out again. So I'm sat in the police cell. I'm thinking away, and I'm thinking away, and I'm thinking, well, if the government is reckless and criminal, which it seems they are, and if no person is above the law, which they're not, then surely we could have them arrested. So I thought I'd call for the inspector of the police station. About an hour later, he came. He's got a tray and two cups of tea and some biscuits on it. I looked at him, and I said, excuse me, officer. I said, you haven't been talking to that duty solicitor, are you, by any chance? He said, as a matter of fact, I have, sir. Very interesting conversation we had as well. Now, how can I help you, sir? I said, well, Following the line of the argument, if the government is reckless and criminal, which it seems they are, and if no person is above the law, which they're not, surely we could have them arrested. He said, oh, he said, I must admit, I never thought of it like that, sir. Suppose you're right in theory, sir. Of course, sir, I couldn't do anything about it myself. I'd lose my job. My family'd be thrown out on the street. I said, you what? I said, you mean to tell me you're a senior police officer and you've got to stand by and watch all this crime happen? I mean, the very earth upon which you're standing by and watching it happen is being destroyed beneath your feet, or you lose your job and get thrown out on the street the same as anyone else. I'm awfully sorry, sir, that would seem to be the case. But I will tell you, sir, that when I joined the police force as a young idealistic man at 17 years old, I took a vow of office. I made a promise, the same as every other police officer, to protect life and property and to uphold the law. I said, you're joking. I said, surely, the most serious threat to life and property on the planet is environmental damage. I mean, Sir David King, the government's chief scientific advisor at the time, 15 years ago, said the threat of environmental damage is more serious than the threat of global terrorism, and he's still got a job. And in terms of injury being done knowingly, surely it's the most serious breach of the law as well. The officer said, well, I can't really argue, sir, but so what? And I said, well, surely, officer, if you take a vow of office to protect life and property and uphold the law, and the most serious threat to life and property on the planet is environmental damage, and the most serious breach of the law on the planet is environmental damage, then you, professionally speaking, should be an environmental campaigner and the rest of the police force. Am I right or wrong? He said, well, I said, I can't really argue you, sir, but there's nothing much I can do. My hands are tied. I said, but hold on a minute. I said, I'm an environmental campaigner now. I'm protecting life and property from the most serious threat to life and property on the planet and upholding the law from the most serious breach of the law. Surely, officer, the entire Green Movement is upholding the police power of office. Is that right or wrong? He said, well, I can't really argue with you, sir, but I told you there's nothing much I can do. I said, well, what would happen if all the working people, the builders, the farmers, the engineers, the miners, the fishermen, the drivers, the lumberjacks, all of this information, I mean, the mortgage contract's unenforceable. It's unlawful to pay tax because the government is criminal. And if the threat of environmental damage is as serious as the threat of a war, it's unlawful to pay tax until we have a state of emergency for the environment. And they all decided to march to London saying, we want to go to work and create a beautiful garden to live in, using all of our amazing technology for the benefit of humanity as it was intended by its inventors. They'd become the Green Movement, then one of the officers. He said, well, I suppose they would, sir, but so what? And I said, well, what would happen if they're all coming down the road, builders, farmers, engineers, tractors, combine harvesters, lorries, bulldozers coming down the road, and all their families and everybody coming down the road, and they've got a big banner at the front which says, the Green Movement, protecting life and property and upholding the law. And the government see them coming and they say to you as a police officer, arrest them, put them back to work, destroying the planet. I said, what would you do? Well, he looked at me, he took his hat off, he scratched his head and he said, do you know, at that point in time, sir, I might have to tell them to bugger off. And I said, well, yeah, that's all very well, you and me talking over the table. What about the rest of the police force? What about the army and the navy and the air force? What would they all do if it come down to it? He said, well, I said, to be honest, sir, I think they'd do the same thing. We're not all entirely stupid, you know.